Hi everyone, we are with another episode of Who's a Friend of the Humanities today, and we have Dr. Deepanvita Pal with us. She's an assistant professor and head of the Department of English at Galsi Mahavidyalaya, West Bengal. It's such a pleasure to have you, Deepanvita, with us. It is wonderful
thank you.
That
you. It's a pleasure for me too.
Yeah, it's wonderful that you agreed to talk to us because I'm like from the discussions we had, you know, we have a lot to talk about your college, how you navigate all these, you know, the crisis in the humanities and all that. So it's an absolute pleasure to have you. Deepanvita will start our discussion talking about, you know, your college, Galsi Mahavidyalaya. Can you give us a brief overview of your college, of where you work, so that our listeners and we can understand, you know, from where you're coming from?
Galsi is actually, you can say, a big village in the town Burdwan. It's almost 25 kilometers from the town of Burdwan. Burdwan is a town again in West Bengal, you know. So it is mainly an agriculture-based area. Mm-hmm. And the students are mostly coming from the minority background in this area. And, mm-hmm. and we proudly boast one thing about our college is that our college is successful in drawing to the educational premises the girl students of the minorities. It is statistics says that mostly 60 to 70% of our students are girls. So so many girls, the majority of girls from the minority area is really a successful thing that we can boast of our college. And this obviously there are some problems because we have to teach in a rural area where almost all the students, most of, if not 100%, almost 80 to 90% of the students are coming from the agricultural background. Mm-hmm. And most of them, as I have already shared, they are first generation college students, you know. Mm-hmm. If not first generation learners, most of them are first generation college students. Mm-hmm. So higher education is a bit unfamiliar thing to their to their backgrounds. Mm-hmm. It's a very new thing. Mm-hmm. And after that, they have to presently cope up with so many fast changes in the educational policy. So obviously, we, along with our students and teachers, we are struggling to cope with that and to deliver maximum of the opportunities to our students.
Absolutely, absolutely, Deepanvita. You teach at a particular department called this English department at your Mahavidyalaya, yes. Right? And I'm sure there are a lot of challenges that the students face when it comes to you know, studying British literature, American literature, and also as well as, you know, Indian classical literature, like studying Mahabharata, like you said. I would like to know, in your perspective as an educator in your department, how do students respond to these texts? You know, like we, in our like theoretical terms, we call those are canonical texts, right? Like the Iliad, then there's Metamorphoses, and then there's, you know, Shakespeare. So how do you think the students respond to these texts?
Actually, first of all, I would like to discuss about the background. As I've already mentioned, the students they come from. So if they are coming from the first generation learners or the first generation college students, mm-hmm. at least, then you can easily understand that the habit of reading is not that much familiar with them. Right. Mm-hmm. So forget about literature regarding English in English language or American literature or world literature, what we have actually to teach. Mm-hmm. Forget about that. Even the literature in Bengali, which is the mother tongue here, they are not familiar with that also. Okay. They are not in the habit of reading. Mm-hmm. They come to us after 12th standard. We teach UG here. So they come to us after 12th standard. Mm-hmm. And till 12th standard, they most of them, almost all of them, don't have even the right. They don't have the exposure to literature itself. So you can easily understand that the difficulty we, the teachers from the literature department particularly, have to deal with. First of all, we have to make them understand what is literature.
Mm-hmm.
Then we have to teach them literature from some other countries for which the even the society or the total background is unknown to them. So this is doubly of, you can say triply difficult to them to first of all start with literature, and then starting with literature they start with the literature of some other country.
Yeah.
Of which they know nothing.
Yeah.
Right. This we have to deal with it. And while doing so, what particularly I have observed, you may say, okay, after that, before that, let me first tell you that the UGC, UGC from India, the recent syllabus they have framed for from 2017 for the UG CBC syllabus. I am thankful to them that they have in the first semester included Indian classicals. So it gives us the scope to make them acquainted with literature from the something from their own things. Just like Mahabharat, in the first semester week is Mahabharat. So it gives me the space, it gives our the teachers the space or the scope, you may say, to introduce them to literature with something they have been known with, they are acquainted with. So I am obviously thankful to the syllabus framers of UGC, you know. Now talking about teaching literature, Mahabharat to start with, you know, even Mahabharata, which is a canonical text in India, you know, what I have found that most of the students, the majority of students, they have not even read that.
Absolutely.
The students from the background of my college, they know the story orally, but they have not read that in detail. So what I start with, I actually do give them an outline of the story. Then I try to make the whole thing interesting by taking them into discussion. Right. And what I have seen, they get much interest then. I try to catch their attention by taking them into my confidence.
Okay.
This is the thing, how you look into it. There are these controversies, such and such controversies are there. What do you think about that controversy?
Okay.
What is your take on that controversy? So in that way, I try to draw their attention towards the discussion, and I have found a great result after doing that.
Okay.
They find it very interesting, and they after a few classes they even ask me, "Ma'am, can we arrange for a debate on that issue?" So as a teacher, at that time I feel much related, you know. And from the after that, in the second semester we teach Shakespeare.
Yes.
So by that time I think students are to some extent ready with literature, with the concept of literature itself, and now they can take literature from some unknown background.
Okay.
And even after the in their syllabus in our university, from Shakespeare in second semester we teach Macbeth, the canonical text. And then again, what I do, the same process I apply, and here again, I try to draw their attention by taking them into the debate, okay. into the discussion. Okay. Right. Just mm-hmm. like for example, I may say while introducing the text, even before starting the text, I mention them about the topics we will be discussing about. Mm-hmm. For example, is Lady Macbeth a witch, the fourth witch, mm-hmm. as it has been said by some critics? Mm-hmm. And I say, and your task is, while we will reading the text, we'll be reading the text in detail, we will be analyzing the text, your task will be to collect evidences in favor or in against of this topic.
Okay, from the text.
And from the text.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. While mm-hmm. reading the text, you have to collect evidences. Okay. You go on collecting evidences either in favor of it or against of the statement. And uh-huh. at the end of our discussion of the whole text, we will gather them and we will have a debate. And they find it very fascinating.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So in this way, we teachers are struggling to present the canonical text to the students, rather cater them to the canonical text on their platter, so that they can easily have a gulp of it.
So I'm also interested in knowing what kind of standard do you have when it comes to the writing? Like, do you have like a very strict standard imposed when you are like, you know, looking at the writing in order to improve the writing? I ask this question because being a student who is equally like, you know, coming from a background which did not have prior exposure to literature, especially British and American literature, I struggled quite a lot as a graduate, undergraduate, when it came to my writing, right? So I'm asking this question because how is that kind of aspect is, you know, like that addressed, or how is that, you know, how are students being supported in that respect?
This is the most difficult problem we have to deal with, okay. The students, because I can't make them interested in literature, okay. by my way of teaching. Mm-hmm. But within 2 or 3 years of span, I can't correct their language skill, right? Okay. I can't teach them from the beginning, that is the grammar from there. Mm-hmm. So, that is a problem we teachers too struggle with that. And if I don't know what you exactly are talking about, if you are talking about the correctness of the writing the language, then are you talking about the correctness of the language or about the flourishing language?
Yeah, it's like sometimes like the English departments have like, you know, we focus too much on being grammatical. You know, the writing being very grammatical, you know, we stress too much importance on developing a, like, you know, a particular style of writing. I think it's important, like, but I think it should be taken in steps, right? So how is that, you know, challenging for the students particularly? Because I know it can be like, you know, very challenging.
Yeah, this is the most difficult challenge to them, because up to their 12th standard, they don't acquire that much skill that they can write the language correctly. Majority of the students. Mm-hmm. And as you were showing, but what you say, when you have come to study literature, English literature, so it is mandatory to know at least to write the language correctly. Hmm. So it is a basic skill we need.
Yeah,
right?
You need the basic
skill. So
yeah.
We obviously, this is the basic skill you must acquire. So yeah, we are particular about that. Sorry, but we have to.
No, but I'm sure you also have like different ways to support students, right? Who are struggling. Like probably you have reading groups, you support, like students can come directly to
obviously.
You.
We have we have a reach library.
Yeah.
And we have the reading room, and we have actually the lessons are basically taught by the teachers. Okay. So the teachers are always ready to help them in improving their language skill. Mm-hmm. Whatever, wherever they need the help, we are always there with the teachers, always mm-hmm. there to help them.
Mm-hmm. I think that is absolutely.
And what I particularly do in the classroom, in the beginning, in the first semester, I tell them to write at least one page every day so that their writing skill could be enhanced.
Okay.
Whatever, it may be right, it may be correct, it may be incorrect, doesn't mm-hmm. matter. But mm-hmm. Write at least one page every day. That helps in enhancing their skill.
Okay, right. So, we spoke on the perspective of the students. What about you as an educator in a department like this at your Mahavidyalaya? What kind of challenges, what kind of limitations, or what kind of potential do you have as an educator in your department?
We have a department of 6 teachers presently.
Okay.
And all of them are very much sincere and very cordial cordial to the students, and we struggle a lot to, first of all, as you have already mentioned, that the first challenge we feel is with their language skill.
Okay.
Right. Mm-hmm. And the second problem, writing skill particularly, mm-hmm. and the second part of this language skill is that their exposure to the language. Mm-hmm. I mean, in audibility, pronunciation, all these things. Mm-hmm. This is the another part of the language skill, mm-hmm. which is even more neglected.
Yeah.
Right. In Bengal, mm-hmm. most of our students come from Bengali medium schools. Bengal is our mother tongue. Yeah. Yeah. So they come from the Bengali medium schools where their first language is Bengali. So they are least exposed to the language. So what, first of all, we try to do, we try to give them an environment where they're more and more exposed to the language. Mm-hmm. For example, so the lectures obviously are delivered in English language. In the beginning, they find it very difficult to understand because they are not familiar to lectures in English language. Mm-hmm. They even request us to please talk in Bangla, ma'am. but then we make them understand this is beneficial to you. We are doing it just for your benefit, and gradually we'll be acquainted with the exposure to the language, which is much needed for you. Otherwise, what will you do when you will pass out and look for a job? You will not be able to go anywhere. So we try to give them the exposure to language, right? By departing the lecture in English, and then we suggest them to read English newspapers or English television channels or series. Mm-hmm. You know, presently there are series, Netflix type of series are there, internet series. Mm-hmm. So we say that whatever you are watching, whenever you are watching at least television, then also watch the English channels. Then you will have the exposure to the language and your ear will be ready. Then the more you will hear, your pronunciation also will be better. Mm-hmm. So in this way we try to battle with the language problem with the language skill, and then there is another part, that is the problem with the literature mm-hmm. the concept of literature. Mm-hmm. So for that we have to make them understand, we have to create their interest into literature. Mm-hmm. That is basically we try to do. We try to convey to them the joy of reading literature.
Okay.
And after 3 years they spend with us, when at the final year I find at least many of them starting reading mm-hmm. novels or poems or stories, you know.
Mm-hmm. Right, that's great. So I think with the COVID-19 situation, a lot of institutes have been, you know, pressurized into go digital, and as a result, teachers, students have to, like, you know, use the digital platforms to, you know, catch up with their learning and teaching and all that. So how do you, or rather, how did you and your students navigate this problem?
How I am navigating with you, you have a demonstration of that, you know, in the beginning of the recording, and you can easily understand the situation of the students. They too are also struggling with it. Now for them, at least for us, the teachers, we can afford the internet. There is no problem with that, right? Though there we can't rely on the network service, but still we can at least afford the internet expenses. But think about, as I have already mentioned, most of my students, they are coming from the first generation learner background and agriculture background. They are economically not that much sound, many of them. So I don't know how the authorities are thinking about pressurizing them to come digital, because we too have been directed to take all the classes online from home, and whenever I join the class, I find most of the students are not being able to afford it. First of all, to afford it. Second, there is another problem. You know, if they can afford a smartphone, first of all, they have to afford a smartphone. Then they have to afford the expenses for the internet connection. And let us assume that, okay, they have somehow, even if they are from the very marginal families, they have somehow afforded the smartphone and the expenses for internet connection. But, you know, I think the social situation of Sri Lanka and India are almost the same. So you can have an idea that the condition of the houses in our, of the common people in our house. So how can you expect each and every student to have that kind of a workstation within their home? That seclusion. You know, even we teachers find it difficult to find that workstation within the home, because you know that I have a small child who sometimes intervenes into my classes. So if the teachers are struggling with the problem, then how would the students be able to cope up with that? I don't know that they are finding it very difficult. And then again, what happens? A few days ago, I found a post in Facebook from one of my fellow teachers who gave a picture of a student who is roaming in the street in the night when the class is being taken, because she is not being able to get the network within the house. So these are actually the scenario, how teachers and students are struggling with this new normal digital teaching and learning process.
Absolutely. You also mentioned that, like, during our initial discussion, that a particular exam now needs to be taken digitally online, and your students find it difficult. I think it's a national exam, right?
Yeah. It is the last final semester exam.
You can easily
understand how much problems they are facing. Yeah, we can understand, but no ways out.
Yes. Now, I saw this the new national education policy that was introduced some time ago in India, and there is some mentioning about developing rural colleges. in terms of, you know, giving, you know, teaching, like giving students the opportunity to enter into teaching professions, and then giving them incentives, giving them, you know, and giving students hostel facilities, books and libraries and all that, right?
Yeah, it sounds great.
Yeah, what is your
sounds great.
Okay, what is your take on that?
If these things can be provided in reality, that's good. Obviously, it will help them. But, you know, we are always doubtful about the declarations and the practical implication of the things, you know.
Yes, I understand. Let's move on to your research. You research on marginalization. Your area of research is marginalization.
Not exactly marginalization.
Okay. Yeah, go on.
Actually, my research area is indigenous people. Actually, it was the study of the works of an indigenous poet from Australia. The Aboriginal Australians, whose name is Kath Walker, later changed her name and took the Aboriginal name as Ujeru Nunukkal.
Okay.
And what I tried to show within my thesis is that how eco-consciousness of the indigenous people are presented or reflected within her poems. And of course, some of the indigenous identities, some features of the indigenous people, Aboriginal indigenous Australians, these things were also a part of my research. Mm-hmm. And then there was a part obvious and a major part of the research was taken by the Aboriginal Australians fighting to regain their rights in their own country from the white Australians, who were actually the settlers, were actually the settlers who came from Britain, Great Britain. This is about my thesis.
So, how do you bring that experience, your research experience, working on the, minoritized, I want to call that minoritized groups. How do you bring that research and its experience and what you've learned there into your classroom, especially in terms of teaching and also especially in terms of supporting your students?
Actually, you know, what I particularly try with it to apply within my classes is the lesson I learned while I was working with the indigenous poet, the Aboriginal poet, that people always should remember their own root. Right.
Okay.
Should never forget our roots. Then only we can be able to achieve something. Otherwise, we will be lost and we will be off nowhere. And that is the most challenging aspect of today's life. We are gradually losing ourselves. We are losing our roots, and everything is so globalized. And this globalization, in this wave of globalization, it is very difficult to retain our own originality.
Mm-hmm.
And that is why I try to emphasize within the classroom, and I try to put it into the heads of my students that if we can't be able to retain our originality, we will very soon be lost.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a wonderful idea, especially. Like, it's not to, like, also because we are losing our roots because we are ashamed, right? We are ashamed to say that we come from this kind of a social economic background, this kind of a cultural background. And it's because we are trying to fit into different systems.
Fit into the global parameters of livelihood.
Yeah, and we want to always be accepted by those systems, and then, you know, like, that is Yeah, that is my personal experience as well, like coming from a very, you know, a kind of a social background, social economic background, and trying to fit into, you know, particular systems, always trying to be accepted by these systems. And then inevitably that's something that, you know, we want to just put aside and move on, right? And I think that's a great idea that you are trying to promote. Let's talk a bit more about your research. You talked about, you know, your study of marginalization within marginalization in your community, especially when it comes to women. Can you talk about that a bit more?
About marginalization within marginalization. Yeah, obviously women are marginalized, but before entering into that, yeah, I would rather like to talk a bit about the co-cultural theory, because okay, about the marginalization theory of marginalization, we know a lot.
Okay.
So I will not go into the theory of marginalization. Okay. But as we are going to talk about marginalization within marginalization, I think mm-hmm. I should say yeah, a few words about co-cultural theory, which mm-hmm. Is absolutely related with the marginalization within marginalization. Okay. Now, co-cultural theory developed by Mark Obe mm-hmm. Actually serves as an analytical lens with which to look at culture as a site of problematic relations. Now, one mm-hmm. of the central assumptions is that societies are structured in hierarchical terms. This creates a dominant position for certain cultural groups, while other groups are maintained in the margins. Mm-hmm. Marginalized groups in this respect can be seen as co-cultures or groups that coexist within a dominant cultural sphere. Mm-hmm. Now, particularly, co-cultural theory is concerned with how co-cultural groups interact with dominant groups in society and mm-hmm. is directly influenced by the situated experiences of co-cultural groups and their point of view. Okay. Now, this co-cultural theory is a unique model. Mm-hmm. It aims to view the world to the extent possible from the perspective of the other. Its mm-hmm. main objective is to study the communicative experience of members of marginalized groups or co-cultural groups. And okay, this theory, it is actually derived from the muted group theory and standpoint theory, mm-hmm. Both feminist perspectives, and is methodologically supported by phenomenology. You know, and you know, according to muted group theory, because societies are hierarchically structured, mm-hmm. different hierarchical positions create asymmetrical relations of power that at mm-hmm. different levels privilege certain groups and marginalize others. Mm-hmm. In this respect, the process forces persons who are not dominant group members to function within a communication system that is not necessarily present, representative of their experience, right? Mm-hmm. And according to the other theory, which is the standpoint theory, because social structures tend to privilege dominant groups, mm-hmm. marginalized cultural groups do not share the point of view of the dominant groups. Okay. Feminist standpoint of theorists, for example, argue that women occupy a distant position or standpoint in culture because under the sexual division of labor enshrined in capitalist patriarchy, women have been systematically exploited, oppressed, mm-hmm. excluded, devalued, and dominated. And mm-hmm. co-cultural theory has been applied to different co-cultural groups, such as women, the homosexuals, the lesbians, mm-hmm. the bisexuals, and even the first generation college students, as okay, I was talking about okay, previously, and okay, people with disabilities and such others, right? Now, however, mm-hmm. despite co-cultural investigation on different co-cultures, mm-hmm. research has been mostly silent about the communicative practices of marginalized groups within okay, a larger marginalized group. In this respect, how to account for asymmetrical relations within co-cultural groups, or what role do hierarchical levels of marginalization play in co-cultural members' communication strategies and outcomes? Mm-hmm. How do the shared experiences of co-cultural groups as marginalized members of society downplay the delivery downplay the diversity of co-cultural groups and the asymmetrical relations of power within their co-cultural positions?
Mm-hmm.
And rather, what communication strategies do co-cultural group members use when dealing with other co-cultural members who maintain a dominant position within the same co-cultural context? Mm-hmm. These are the recent investigations which are being indirectly recognized, these questions. Right. Okay. Now, coming back to your question about the marginalization of the indigenous women.
Mm-hmm.
As I have studied about them a lot, because the subject of my thesis was an indigenous woman.
Okay.
So I can say that they are often described as the custodians of traditions and cultures.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
They bear the prime responsibility of ensuring the culture and traditions of their peoples are passed on to future generations, and are the most noticeable expressions of their people's distinct culture. You know, it is always the women who have to hold on the colorful aspect of within their attire, within their ornaments, etc.
Mm-hmm.
They have to afford that. The culture, they have to afford that.
Mm-hmm.
Even if you know that women have to wear the traditional dresses, the men can easily go for the globalized ones, but women have to stick to the traditional ones, you know. Yeah. Yet, as in any society, indigenous women too share the same burden of institutionalized gender bias mm-hmm. as their non-indigenous sisters, yet they have a heavier load. Indigenous women are the most vulnerable among indigenous peoples and
mm-hmm.
face double discrimination on the basis of their gender for being women, and secondly for their ethnicity for being indigenous.
Okay.
In some parts of the world, there is triple burden to bear, as indigenous women are also poor, obviously. Now
mm-hmm.
the challenges and barriers may vary from country to country and even the community to community, but indigenous women in developing countries such as India, Bangladesh, I think Sri Lanka
yeah.
too,
mm-hmm.
face the same structural imbalance in gender equality as their sisters living in Canada or Norway, the first developed countries.
Mm-hmm.
What unites indigenous women is their common struggle for greater recognition of their rights as indigenous peoples, and within this broader framework, the more specific focus of their rights as indigenous women. Apart from a few exceptions, indigenous people's struggle for self-determination have in most cases either totally bypassed gender considerations or deprioritized them with a vague idea of somehow addressing them at some undefined future time, you know. And along with that, the indigenous women face another aspect of gender bias, this time from within the community. Right? Within the
mm-hmm.
exception of matriarchal societies, the majority of indigenous communities follow patrilineal lines,
mm-hmm.
with women stepping in only in the absence of a male heir. This has significant impact on women's socioeconomic and financial security and contributes to her vulnerability. Indigenous women's dependence on men within the family and on the extended family has become strongly reinforced by the asymmetrical rules of inheritance.
Mm-hmm.
Discriminatory inheritance laws further hinder women's overall emancipation. The inheritance laws of most indigenous peoples, including the most numerous groups, tend to be discriminatory against women. The common trend of the indigenous peoples is that only sons inherit landed property.
Okay.
Generally, women cannot claim paternal property as of right. And as you have provoked me in the beginning to discuss about literature, and I know you know literature people don't leave even the smallest opportunity to insert literature into anything, you know. So I can't resist myself from further referring to the stories of an indigenous writer from India.
Okay.
Hasda Sovendra Shekhar, a writer from the Santal community.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
He is an emerging writer, and I am in love with his works.
Mm-hmm.
So I would definitely like to refer to some of his stories in this particular
Please.
Connection. Okay.
Yes.
If you permit.
Thank yes, you. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Yes. Yeah.
So I would like to cite just one or two examples of
mm-hmm.
the marginalization within marginalization of the Santal women from his stories.
Mm-hmm.
The first one is from his novel, The Mysterious Ailment of Rupi Baske. where we are introduced to Rupi Baske, who is the protagonist, who stands for the doubly marginalized Adivasi women. The women in general are marginalized as the housewife, whose so-called unproductive domestic duty never offers them the minimum recognition, you know. They are mostly deprived of their social and individual rights. They are the easiest victims of the patriarchal tradition of the joint family. Obviously, I insist on that. Joint family, I think, is an instrument of victimizing the women.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And such other practices, most of them which are traditional. Thus, we find Rupi Baske, in spite of being such a strong woman who can bear even the pain of giving birth to a child in the midst of the field, in a paddy field, while she was sowing the plants. And she's such a strong woman, even she withers away gradually, basically due to the lack of self-confidence in performing household duties properly to become a good mother as well as a good wife. And the second is from the story whose name is Bashuji, where there is a girl, Bijaya, who is the daughter of Murmu family. She can't find a suitable groom. She's a girl of regular Santal features with a height of 5 and a few inches. Much tall, tall, dark, plump, and soft-spoken. To crown all her qualities, she has got the amount of education which is not that much common within the other girls in her village, even within the boys of the village. And she is an honors graduate with an ambition to become a teacher, an ambition to become self-dependent in future. Even such a girl is refused by suitors, and the reason behind the refusal is her dark complexion.
Okay.
You know. And the author comments, Santal men go for looks. But what is particularly disappointing in this incident is the fact that the Santal men who suffer from the humiliation themselves for the darkness of their skin, you know, they are causing the same for the girls of their own community. This is very strange, I must say. So from that we can easily guess the condition of the indigenous women within their community.
Absolutely. So do you also incorporate this kind of texts into your teaching in classes? Despite, you know, all the Shakespeare, Milton and all that, is that kind of text also taught in your classes?
Yeah, recently. That is why in the beginning I told you that I am thankful to the UGC for this recent CBCS syllabus, which is into vogue from 2017.
And
it includes every type of literature. Every type of literature from each and every sphere, they have tried to at least put it into the syllabus.
We are
trying to do that.
Deepanvita, I'm moving on to the final question, and I'm trying to phrase this question as carefully as possible. For her, like, with the education that the girls get at your English department, at your department, are there any ideological and attitudinal changes that they face when they, you know, go back to their, you know, communities, when they go back to their houses? Like, I'm sure there can be different, you know, frictions between families once they develop this, you know, kind of ideologies that, you know, usually English departments promote. So what kind of an idea do you have about that?
Yeah. You have hit the bullseye.
Yeah.
So now, you know, that is not that much. Actually, what happens, even, you know, that I teach in a very, very remote college, which is from a rural background. So what, particularly, frankly speaking, what we teachers still have to do is restrain our, in some cases, we have to restrain our ideologies too. We can't put everything we want to put into their ears, because their families might feel offended.
Okay.
That, you know. And we always have that fear that if we put so much progressive ideas into their head, then and they tell it, go home and apply them into the house, then the whole village will come to the college and tease the teacher. So what are you, what actually are you teaching our students? Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. Jokes apart, I rather would like to share an experience with you.
Yes.
When I joined, before joining into the college, I used to teach in a school.
Okay.
School or the 10th standard, 10 plus 2 standard high school. Right. Children used to come to read, and there, as you know, that I was not that at that time. I have just passed my master's and have joined the school, and I was not that much habituated to wear sarees, and I had to travel to reach the school for 1 hour in a local bus.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So it was very difficult to wear the saree and go to the workplace. So after much struggling with this is another episode of the story.
Okay.
Struggling much with this sari salwar debate, finally I got the permission from my authority to come to the school with salwar suits.
Okay.
And then the questions I had to face from the local people, that if the teacher is coming with wearing a salwar suit, what would our students learn? What would our kids learn from you? You know? So I couldn't tell them that if they learns to feel free to wear in which they are comfortable, that as a teacher, I would feel pleased. I will feel delight. I couldn't tell that.
Okay.
You know?
Okay.
You can understand why refer to that story. If this is the scenario, that if the teacher comes in salwar suit, the students are having a bad lesson. This is the mindset of the people of the village. So you can easily think about what you are asking about, applying those that they are studying into the, or learning into the classroom, then what is the outcome of that? What would the result they are facing?
Yeah. Now, obviously, like in teaching, one of the aspects is talking about patriarchy and oppression of women. And, you know, we cannot not talk about those, right? When we are especially reading those literary texts and all that, especially the text that you cited, like this about Santal community.
And in the last semester I have to teach feminism.
Yes.
Feminist theory.
Yeah. So what was, do students share the experience, like, you know, trying to navigate this kind of ideas?
What we have to do. Mm-hmm. Yeah, what I have to do from within the tenure, I take it as a 3-year course. Okay. The whole thing. Right. Mm-hmm. The whole training as a 3-year course, and within 3 years gradually try to by slow poisoning. So gradually I try to put those ideas, progressive ideas, the idea of self-dependence, self-respect, all these things, I try gradually to put into their head, so that they cannot it doesn't come radically, so that there would be a repercussion. So that is the method actually I like to adopt.
Do you also provide assistance to these students, like, you know, go beyond their BA, to do their MA, to do their PhD, to secure some, you know, try to secure some funding and try to, you know, is that also?
Yes, that. We from the department, we try to give that assistance as much as possible from us. We have, being a senior teacher after 12 years of teaching, we have that kind of some kind of influence in some places, educational places. Try to guide them to the proper place. To get the assistance, we can say them the ways or the places where they can get the assistance, and if anyone is interested in higher study or in getting the job, we try to provide our best, whatever we can do within our limited resources.
Absolutely, Deepanita, it was wonderful talking to you, and I think I learned quite a lot today. I absolutely have a different perspective, and I'm really glad that we could have you today to talk to you. And as I ask,
thank you.
As I ask every guest at the end, do you have anything to say that I couldn't ask you, that I failed to ask you? Any last remarks that you would like to add at the end?
No, I think whatever I had to say about my students, my college, about the marginalization of women, just two or three things I would like to add. That is, I thought about talking about the marginalization of the even among the women, about the prostitutes or the dynes particularly. You know, the prostitutes are literally marginalized. They are literally thrown out of the society. They are bound to live into the peripheries of the village or town, you know. And they are like the untouchables. They are not accepted even by the women. Even the women hate them. Even the white-collared women, whom we may say, they hate them. So there is a triple layer or triple level of marginalization that these prostitutes feel. Then we have the dynes, and the dynes who are the worst victim of it. They are often the victims of witch hunting. You know, they are burnt alive. If someone is suspected as dynie, in some places we know that some now and then the news comes of witch burning. So these are the aspects of women, marginalized women, even marginalization within marginalization. So they are really having a very, very wretched life. So we should also academically, if not socially, what we can do through discussions, academically at least, we can take their account into discussion. So that we can in near future or remote future, we can provide a better world for them.
Absolutely. Thank you, Deepanita. Thank you so much for joining
us
today.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Yes. And we will again meet in another episode sometime. Yeah, after some time. I think we will have another whole lot of perspectives.
I would love to. Yeah. It was a nice experience talking to you.
Yeah, it was so nice talking to you too. Like, we have been communicating for the past couple of weeks about this. And thank you so much for your support.
About a few days.
Thank you. Thank you, Deepanita. And I wish you all the best for all the good things that you plan for your class, your students. Thank you so much.
And best wishes for your future life too.
Thank you so much.